Hey, this is Canton Jones Show. Whoa, hey, hey, this is Canton Jones Show. Whoa, hey, yeah, this is Canton Jones Show. Whoa, hey, yeah.
Ladies and gents, welcome to the Canton Jones Show. I am your host, Canton Jones, in the building right now. Yeah, we got Bakemusic in the building. Heather Hamilton is in the building as well. But first, you know, we got to get our party on. Tell Grandma's song. Let's go. Hey, hey, there's no other name that's higher than yours, Lord. There's no other name that's higher than yours, Lord. So we call him Jesus. I'm here, you, your mama, your cousin too. We love y'all. Keep it locked right here on the Canton Jones Show. Let's go. Welcome back. This is the Canton Jones Show. I'm your host, Canton Jones, and this conversation that we are about to have with this young lady is going to have you on the edge of your seats. She is an author of a new book. It's called Returning to Eden. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage and to the studio, Miss Heather Hamilton. Hey,
this is Canton Jones Show. Whoa, hey, hey, this is Canton Jones Show. Whoa.
Yeah. This is Canton Jones. So I want to dive right into this. I was born and raised Church of God in Christ, Pentecostal,
yep.
Evangelical. I understand all of that. I am an ordained Southern Baptist pastor, so
yep.
I understand the perspective that we have, but you have a different perspective based off an experience that you had, and I want you to get into your perspective and your book. I just,
yep.
I want to have a conversation. I've been waiting on this conversation.
Me too. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for having me. And as you're talking about your background, I'm like nodding like, yes,
yeah.
Yes. My background was, you know, from a child, it was 7 years old, Awanas. If you are not familiar with what that is, it's like, you know, you go learn Bible verses, mm-hmm. very Southern Baptist. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, we thought like rebellion or breaking away was like, we're non-denominational.
Right.
Now, you know?
Right. You're real radical when you're non-denominational.
Yeah, it's like we've lost our religion. We're non-denominational.
Right.
So it was just evangelical. And that was the folk, like just this love for Jesus from when I was 7 years old. Mm-hmm. And that was really just the trajectory of my life was, you know, as I moved through the church, it was, you know, youth camps and, you know, real emotional worship services where, you know, when I'm like 11, 12 years old, I'm like, you know, I'll be a missionary. You know, it was like, it always felt like this life and death thing that I had to say, like, who else is going to do it? I have to do it kind of thing. So that was the trajectory all throughout adulthood. And I met my husband in the church. We had our three kids and we were just very immersed in this. It was the evangelical ecosystem. And I loved it. You know, there's been a lot of people who've quote unquote deconstructed because, you know, things didn't make sense or whatever. And that wasn't the case with me. I wasn't trying to question anything or whatever. And about 4.5 years ago, long story short, I just had some major realizations about my life, some trauma that I had not ever acknowledged or dealt with that suddenly just, bam, came into crystal clear focus. And I was 32, I had just had my third child, and I just had a complete nervous breakdown. And so it wasn't, you know, like some other stories where people like struggle with mental health or struggle with substance abuse, anything like that. I had never had that as part of my background. And so suddenly I was just plunged into this mental health crisis slash abyss. And it also felt like this very, this spiritual descent, like into darkness. And it was so fast and so intense. That just kind of over the course of a few days, it kind of climaxed in this, really this moment of complete abyss, despair, where I had thought, you know, if I'm ever in, you kind of imagine like what you would do in very desperate moments in your life. And I kind of had it in my head, like God would rescue me from this. And in that moment, it was just this nothingness. Which was devastating to me because whatever I had pictured might happen, I realized was not the reality of the situation. And for me, it was a recognition of like, this is hell. I had had this picture of what hell was based on what I was taught. And in this moment, it was like this inner knowing where my soul just felt like untethered out in space. There was there was no one coming to get me, essentially. And so at this point, you know, I had never dealt with any kind of suicidal ideation, nothing like that. But it was this recognition of like, this is complete overwhelm for my nervous system. And this is not going to end well if I don't get help. And so we called 911. The emergency response team came to my house. And when I opened the door, I immediately start word vomiting about, you know, kind of what's happening because I don't understand it. And when the woman who is standing on my porch starts speaking to me, I immediately recognize that it's a transgender woman. And in my framework of what I had been taught in church, it was very much this orientation of like, I have the truth, I'm the helper, I'm the rescuer, I'm the person who's supposed to be helping people like you. I don't have a trust. There's that a lack of trust here. Exactly. And so I felt fear in that moment. Like, I don't know if I can trust you. And this is very disorienting to me because I'm so vulnerable right now. But as she just kept speaking, for the first time in that week, you know, I've been trying to get my family and, you know, people at church, whatever, to understand like the depth of the crisis. And I couldn't exactly like get anyone to really see it precisely. And suddenly this woman was, and it was like time just kind of collapsed and I felt the presence of Christ coming off of her. It was like this sweet, gentle aroma, what I could probably only describe as like a mystical experience. And so it was, you know, I had like my rational cognitive mind going like, Jesus is not supposed to be speaking to me in a body that looks like this. But this is what is happening. And so I suddenly had this crystal clear moment of perceiving Christ correctly, but it was very disorienting for my
Your belief system. We gotta pay some bills. We will be right back with Heather Hamilton. This is amazing. Don't go anywhere. She's getting ready to get into this book. Welcome back to the Canton Jones Show. We are in an in-depth conversation with Heather Hamilton about her experience with anxiety. You are talking to a transgender person, feeling like you're getting ministered to, when usually the idea of our church background says that that really can't happen. It's supposed to be the other way around. So after that experience, God give you the I guess this book.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, in the you know, about 3 years from there, I started writing this book. But in the in between time, I had this sense. I had talked to you a little bit about the experience of what I felt like was hell, and the metaphor that kept coming to my mind was, this is the belly of the whale. I knew where I was. And suddenly some of these stories that had just kind of been relegated to something weird that you talk about in Sunday school, you know, where it was like, that doesn't seem like a rational possibility, but like, I guess God can do anything. So you kind of cram this cognitive dissonance together about the stories, but they're not really a part of your life. Suddenly it was like the stories were very poignant metaphors for describing the process that I felt. And it felt like the old Heather had died and been sucked into this belly. And it's like, what happens in a belly? It's where the old is digested and broken down and metabolized into literally a new creation. Like we eat, the food becomes our body. And then out of the belly is the rebirth. So it was suddenly the process that was taking place in me as an adult felt more in line with like the pattern that was being revealed through the stories. So it's like you have this pattern in Jonah where he actually says in the King James Version, out of the belly of hell I cried. He was saying, I was in hell. And then, you know, we see in Jesus's crucifixion, you know, you're going to see the sign of Jonah. Like, why is he talking about a whale? What does that mean? Why is he talking about fish and swallowing and whatever? And, it, you know, we see Jesus dies. It says he's 3 days in the heart of the earth. And it's like naming this psychological pattern. And so the stories started, it came to me that this was naming spiritual patterns. And so the cognitive dissonance of feeling like faith was this like white knuckled grip on something that seemed implausible relaxed for me. And it was this sort of trust and relaxation in the natural process of, you know, life, death, resurrection, which is the pattern that's revealed in creation. You know, it's just, you know, when a caterpillar goes into its cocoon, from that limited perspective, that could feel like hell to the caterpillar. Like its body is literally being melted before it's transformed in this beautiful butterfly, and there's this rebirthing process. But the caterpillar submits to that process. So it's not this, you know, strife like we see in Jonah, like, oh, please, you know, don't let this happen to me. So I saw the pattern everywhere, which is what I try to illuminate in the book, was how this is showing up in all these characters and all these stories. But the difference between Jonah and Jesus was Jonah's resistance to it and Jesus's submission to it. And just this relaxation into being able to trust this process.
In this process, like, talk about the name, Returning to Eden. Like, why Eden?
So something that happened in my experience was as this transgender woman was talking to me, it was like something inside of me woke up that felt almost like a spiritual amnesia, like something brand new, but also that had always been there. And so what happened after that was this process of almost detoxing from every identity that I had attached to myself, you know? I'm a mom, I'm a Christian in this religion, I'm, you know, a producer, I'm a woman, I'm a whatever. And it was discovering the face that I had before I was born, like my authentic essence before I even came here. And it felt like a return to the garden of like this unitive consciousness before the mind starts labeling and dividing,
right.
which was represented by Adam
right.
naming all the animals. You know,
right.
this is what this is all called.
Mm-hmm.
That's the function of the brain, which is like a good and healthy thing,
right.
you know, that we need to develop, but it also puts us into separation with our soul,
right.
our authentic essence.
And that's why, you know, when Moses asked God, what should I call you? You can't really name me because
yes.
you can't compartmentalize who I am.
Yes.
I am that I am.
Yes.
So just tell them that I am.
Yes.
You know?
And that silence is terrifying.
Mm.
It really is. And even to come to that void or place of nothingness in us is a terrifying, you know, when Nicodemus is like, you want me to go back into the womb? What are you talking
right.
about?
Right, what are you talking about?
Yeah, it's like, I want to strip you of every identity you've attached to yourself
yeah.
and rebirth you so that who you are can, the inside can become like the outside, like the spirit and the flesh can become one. There's not this contradiction anymore.
Ooh.
So the two becoming one flesh to me is more of a spiritual principle that happens in each individual.
Yeah. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, you have to get this book. Heather Hamilton, thank you for this time.
Thank you for having me.
It's like I could talk to you for an hour. But you guys, stick around. We have Bakemusic in the building. It's gonna do some hot, hot, his sound check was crazy. So you need to stick around for that. More on the Canton Jones Show. Welcome back to the CAJO Show, the Canton Jones Show. Hey, we are getting ready to be blessed with the gospel sounds of Bakemusic singing Persevere.
Understand, had to confess all that I had done for a clean slate. Oh, I had to go through and I had to fight. I had to suffer and I had to die. Every time I gave up, for every time I said no. Nothing compared to the yes I gave to persevere.
Persevere.
Persevere. Oh, yeah. I had to persevere.
Persevere.
Ooh, yeah. I had to persevere. Age 9, lost my mama. 24, the mother of my daughter. But it was different. I had to witness my baby go through the same thing. Y'all, and she was even younger. At that age, she couldn't even comprehend that the pain she had eventually would end. I know it's gonna end. Oh, yeah. Couldn't tell nobody else, they wouldn't understand. Had to confess all that I had done, but nothing compared to the yes I gave to persevere. Said, oh, persevere. Oh, yeah. If I could
make a minute to just one person out there. Your situation that you're going through is very temporary. Your God, our God, is on your side. I guarantee you, I'm a living testimony that he's never left you. He's right there going through everything that you're going through, right there with you. All you have to do is look to the hills for what's coming to help. Yes. Gotta keep going. You gotta keep going. Oh, 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 oh. I'm a living testimony of his grace and favor. That you can persevere. All you have to do is make a morning affirmation and say, I'ma get up out of this bed. I'ma get up out of this mindset. I'ma get up out of this destructive relationship, this destructive environment. There is more in you. Hallelujah. Oh, 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 I had to persevere.
Bakemusic! Oh, my God, bro. You are anointed, man of God. Yeah,
bless
yeah.
You.
Where are you from?
I'm originally from South Georgia, but I live here in Atlanta.
South Georgia represent. Yes, how long have you been here?
I've been here since I graduated high school, 2006.
Oh, wow. Yeah, you ATL.
I'm ATL now.
So, Matt, you going to do another song for us?
I am.
What's the name of this song?
This is a single that I put out last year. It's called Made It.
All right. Now, we need to get in contact with you. Give me your social media handles.
Bakemusic, Bakemusic. That's Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, all of it. It's all the same.
Woo! That's our show, ladies and gentlemen. Yes. Bakemusic taking us out. Let's get it, boy.
Yes,
do
sir.
Your thing, homie.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Hey. We're gonna pick it up a little bit. Here we go.
Can you hear a sinner's prayer? From way up there, can you reach down real low? Show me that you care. Where do I turn when I'm feeling down? Call you, can you hear me now? Where do I turn when I have to run? My lifesaver when I'm finna drown. Been through the storm and the rain, but you heal my pain, yes. You never judge, never blame me. I'm so grateful that you saved me. I nearly lost my faith, nearly lost my mind. I didn't think I was gonna make it. Didn't think I was gonna make it. Oh, but you picked me up and you turned me around. I didn't think I was gonna make it. I didn't think I was gonna make it. Oh. Hands up if you know you made it. Get up on your feet and let me see you praise him. And let him know that you love him. Let him know that you trust him. Hands up if you know you made it. Get up on your feet and let me see you praise him. And if you wanna make a change, all you gotta do is call his mighty name. Nearly lost my faith, nearly lost my mind, yeah. I didn't think I was gonna make it. I didn't think I was gonna make it.